Hello, everyone. My name is John McMaster, and I have a bit of history with open source silicon FPGA tools and that sort of stuff. I used to work on, kind of Xilinx 7 series FPGA bitstream documentation. I've been a big fan of open source EDA tools for a long time and was really excited to see open tapeout moving forward and the surrounding tools. One of my big hobbies, though, is I like to decap chips and take microscope pictures of them. So when I heard that Open Tapeout had come out, I was really excited to get some chips and snap a few pictures. So that's what this presentation's about, is just kind of getting some nice pictures to show you what's inside the Open Tapeout run. So with that, I'm gonna get started.
Interrupt you because I think I confused you with the terminology. So Open Tapeout's just the name of this conference. These are the first chips from the Google-sponsored EFabless SkyWater Shuttle.
MPW-1, I believe is its name.
Yeah.
As in the title, so sorry about that. But anyways, yeah. So with MPW-1, here I use K layout. I think a lot of people are using Magic. I popped up some of the design files. And you get some sort of file like a screen like this. And my interest is kind of traditionally been what happens after this. So, you go through all the wafer processing, and I deal with a lot of like the failure analysis, the delayering, decapping. If you actually want to see what happens, in those post processing steps. So we're going to start by taking a look at the packaging, and then start going lower and lower in the chip. Taking to see what we can see each layer. So first thing was here I was really excited to get back some of the MPW-1 chips. I actually never figured out which specific chip this was, but we have the part numbers, so I'm sure someone can shout that out in the comments if they know what this chip is. And first thing I like to do is just get a little bit of just visual nice feel, is just get some x-rays, because once you start using acids and kind of stuff like that to open up these chips, you lose a lot of details. And this is my favorite little cute little x-ray machine. It's the size of the microwave oven. It's one of my favorite little tools, because like I feel like you can make popcorn in it, but no, it actually is a full x-ray machine. So anyways, you see the little chip in the middle there. I tried that, and the x-ray wasn't so good initially. But x-rays are kind of a funny thing, where you can make your own optics by basically change the optical the properties, the projections, just by moving the chip a little bit closer. So I put this little plastic box there, and essentially that magnified the x-ray, because the source is at the top, and as this kind of cone projection of x-rays comes out, now it's going to magnify it on the sensor below, which is that little black square, because it's had more distance for the beam to diverge. And skipped over one there. There we go. And then so once we do that, now we get a much nicer x-ray. So now on the left, you can see some of the bond wires. You see that little circle there. You see the inner square, rectangle, I should say. Can you see my mouse pointer? I don't know if you can, because then I could actually point to things.
Yeah,
but
I can see it.
Great. So this right here, these are where the bond wires. This is the pad frame right here. This is the die attach paddle, which is used for kind of thermal and whatnot. We saw that gold chunk basically in the previous slide. And then out here you have the general lead frame, and you can in fact also see that the general paddle attaches in a few locations here. And then I've contrast enhanced this image on the right, so you can see a little bit more detail here with the bond wires going and stuff. So, so I always find that interesting. Just a first cut, you can do this without damaging a chip too much. But what we really want to do is actually see the silicon. So let's go a little bit deeper. And so starting with this package, let's start adding some acid. And the first thing you get is this shot here. And the first thing that struck out to me that was interesting, because I don't do as many modern chips, you see on the outside here, this is the original black package color, but the epoxy kind of discolored this weird yellowish and kind of became foamy with the acid addition. And for me, I kind of washed these with acetone as I'm going, and the acetone didn't really like this to dissolve this. So I think if I was doing a lot more modern chips, I would probably adjust my solvent process, but this was cool. Started seeing the dye. We almost see it there, and start seeing the bond wires. So let's go a little bit further and see if we can get a nicer shot there. Great. With a little bit of acid, now we can clearly see, and this is that first dye. It was 001. So dye A1 here. And, you know, we can see these gold bond wires on the outside here. And that was actually one of my first questions looking at this. I was curious. I understood that a lot of things had moved to maybe copper bond wires. I'm not a packaging expert. I'm always really cautious on opening up modern ships, because if I find copper bond wires in here as opposed to gold, I have to use different chemicals or it actually can damage the wires. So just kind of interesting side note to me. I'd be curious to follow up with someone if they were involved with packaging to learn a little bit more about how some of the selections were done here. But anyways, first die shot there, and I was pretty excited. Let's go a little bit deeper because we can't quite see what's going on here yet. So let's go. I took then a higher resolution shot. The first shot you saw was taken with a, like an inspection microscope, like you'd use for soldering. But this one is a panorama taken with a metallurgical microscope, and it's capable of taking much higher resolution photos as a result of this optical setup. You know, it uses more traditional objectives like you'd find on a biological microscope or something like that. And then I could actually start. It's a little bit hard to see on this image, but I could then read out that this chip that was X-Acto knifed in A1 is chip 00010001. I'm sure somebody could look that up and figure out what that is. And then I had a second chip, which I also decapped, which had also been kind of stenciled in E5, and you can also see its chip ID there. So got a couple of chips here. And then I also cleaned this one a little more aggressively. You can see in this first one here, most of the bond wires are still attached. I was scrubbing a little bit and knocked some off over here. And then this one over here, the second one, I didn't even keep in the package. I just said, just give me a clean die. So almost all of the bond wires are gone on this one. You can see one of them still straggler over there. But anyways, so okay, now great. So we have a few dies. They're out of the package. We have a clear view of them. Let's start digging a little bit deeper and see what we can see. So the first thing that I was really excited about was taking a look at logos. I just like it. People do die art. I'm a big fan of doodling on chips. Make the process exciting, And so here is a K layout. I have brought up the open source hardware logo, and you can see this is implemented on. I don't know which metal layer it is, but one of the metal layers. And we start taking a look, and if you add a little bit more of the layers around it, it starts looking a little more like this. So now we have some of the CMP fill here. So I'm not actually clear if most of the designers deal with a CMP fill or not. Maybe that's a question for Matt. If you actually want to manufacture these chips and you have an empty area on them, you need to fill in spacers, they call CMP fill, to make sure that the whole chip polishes cleanly. So depending on which stage of your design, you may or may not see this, but it does make it to the final design. So anyways, this is a little closer to what it looked like in actual manufacturing. And then if we skip ahead, now we can go to the actual die, and here you can see multiple types of CMP fill. So on the upper layer here, which is a coarser metal layer, you can see this larger CMP fill. But then you go to the lower layers, which have more detail, you can actually see much finer grain CMP fill down there. So for me, that was just kind of fun because I actually had the source layouts here, and you can actually see these layers here, lining up here, and the metal layers here and all of that. So I was very fascinated by this and just kind of fun to see for the first time. First of all, very excited. I've never seen the open source hardware logo, on an actual chip like this. And then also seeing all the design layers line up. And at least for me, that was a really fun experience, always seeing these as a black box in the past. So that was my first look. That was kind of fun. The next thing that I thought that would be an easy thing to look at were the bond pads. But we're going to go in the opposite direction in this one. We're going to start with a die image and then go to the CAD, and I'll show you why. One more thing in between. And then here's also just a quick shot of the copyright and stuff, which I always appreciate. People put labels and stuff on dies, tell you what they are. Here's one of the bond pads and kind of some IO kind of stuff around it. Unfortunately, I didn't get a chance to take a look at exactly what this was, but it was more selected because it was something that I could easily find on the die. So with this bond pad at the right and these, you know, kind of regular metal structures. I was just doing a quick comparison to say, oh, you know, I can see these and map these to the design files. So with that in mind, here we go. And I've taken some layers on the CAD, and we can see them here now. You can see some of the actual bond pad structure, I believe, over here. Some of these metal layers here, you know, these large power buses at the top and bottom here. And if you flip back and forth here, you can see, you know, that these I roughly aligned these so you can kind of see them match up. And, you know, depending on whether I select CMP or not, you know, you may or have, you know, some of these other things in the shot. And the reason why I don't have everything selected in this view, you might add, because if I do, it looks like this. And you really can't see anything. So that was actually one of the biggest challenges for this, for getting some quick photos here and matching them to the layout. It was, you know, now I actually have the layouts, but at least the way it got displayed with transparency settings and stuff, I was trying to fiddle with this. It became kind of a hot mess when you tried to take a look at it there. And going from this to this photo here, at least I cannot quickly translate between those two. But this intermediate view is a little bit clear. So one interesting thing for me, at least, you know, if I start working with this, either getting a little bit more comfortable with K-Layout, maybe trying out Magic. One of the issues I found, at least, was K-Layout didn't have the layer names. I only had the layer numbers. So I was kind of, you know, traveling blind, just kind of saying, turn this layer on, maybe that CMP fill. And I really had to fiddle quite a bit. So anyway, side note.
Yeah, there. John, I'm just going to come in here and say it took me a little while to get to grips with K-Layout, but you can load the tech file from the PDK, and then that names the layer. So that's super useful.
Okay,
and
good to know.
Then you can do a right-click hide all unused layers, and then you can turn off the ones you don't want to see, that, and then turn off all the text, and that makes it a lot easier. So,
yeah, that's good to know. Thank you. I'll give that
we'll have a session later, and I'll show you how to do it.
Sounds good. Thank you very much. Yeah, anyway, so there's that. But, you know, at least a lot of people, when they think of chips, you know, they don't think of the actual metal routing. You know, people are like, oh, I hear these chips have transistors. And, you know, even though, you know, a lot of people that look at chips, you know, at the microscope, you're looking at metal most of the time, people think of the actual transistors, you know, as part of this. So let's dig into the transistors briefly. So I started by just taking a look at the standard cell library, or at least what I was able to find quickly in the hierarchy viewer. And NAND2 seems like as good of a stereotypical cell as any, or at least that's what it called it. To me, it looks like this is maybe more than a NAND2. Regardless, I'm not going to worry too much about semantics about exactly what cell this is. It looks like some sort of logic cell, or at least two logic cells or something like that. But anyways, so we got this guy here. And so then I zoomed out a bit and I said, okay, now what does this look like at more like the floor planning level? And so we basically have these rows here. My quick interpretation of this, just kind of based on the size of these being a little bit larger than these, I'm assuming these are the, once again, I didn't have the layer names, is I'm assuming these are kind of the p-doped transistors here. There's the p-fets, and these are the n-fets here. And it looks like, at least on this particular chip then, so we have kind of two rows of n-channel, two rows of p-channel, and kind of alternates, or at least in this section of the chip. So something like if you have the CMOS, then, you know, this block here will be complementary with this block. This block will be complementary with this block, and so on as you go down the row. So, okay, anyways, cool. So then I started trying to figure out, you know, what are my options to actually delayer the chip? Because the previous chip, the previous layers, the metal layers were on top. So that's fairly easy to get to. But if you want to start doing stuff like this, you have to get a little more creative. You have to either use high precision polishing. You have to use chemicals like hydrofluoric acid. You know, it gets a little more exciting. And so I went a few directions there. The first thing is that I actually had some chips from the, I don't know what the right, Matt, maybe you could comment. What's the proper name for this run of chips here? Is there a group name for these?
I think this was, so this is the Open RAM test chips.
Yeah, so the Striver Open RAM and Striver 2, I think are
okay.
The official names.
Mohammed's probably the best person to ask about that, actually, and he's in the comments, so we can just read what he writes in the comments next.
But anyway, so these are, as I understood it at least, and I actually do have legitimate questions here. So my understanding was that these were an earlier test of a lot of the PDK and stuff, and they should be a good analog for what actually made it to MPW1. And I already had some of these decapped and had already done these processing on them. So I started by taking a look at those as kind of an analog. And the interesting thing, though, is so this is a picture after hydrofluoric acid had been applied to the chip. I can see what looks to me like, you know, some kind of complementary logic. So if we take a look down here, for example, this is larger than this. So this is presumably the P channel over here, and this is the N channel over here. So that's interesting, and we can kind of match that up to some of the stuff earlier. But at least this one is not in that nice sort of row fashion like I saw on the MPW1 layout. So unfortunately, I didn't get a chance to chase this down in more detail. Matt, do you by chance know about the place and route? And
isn't it just rotated 90 degrees if you look at it on the side?
Oh, I'm sorry. You're right. I think you might. No, that's not true. That's not true. Because in the other thing, you would then have all blues in one row.
Oh, so the blue is N and the white is P, is it?
But maybe you're right. Maybe you're right. And I've actually misinterpreted that. And maybe the blue is not actually P. And then I don't know what's going on there. But you're right. If I throw away the coloring and I just say, like, hey, just rotate 90 degrees, I think you actually might be right. And then this would be like the P here. This would be the N there. And then that all works out. So, yes, I think you're right. I think this just needs to be rotated 90 degrees, and that in fact would line up. And you're right. Now that I look at this, you know, these look like these are complementary pairs and whatnot. So, okay, cool. I don't know what's going on with the coloring then. I don't know how that fell out. But you're right. It does look like the same sort of stuff. And that should say pre-MPW1 there. But anyways, the other thing I was hoping to do was to put these under scanning electron microscope. So this is the same model I got recently. It was an upgrade from what I had previously. It's not my actual unit. Unfortunately, it broke recently, very shortly after I got it. It was working very briefly, and then it's developed a vacuum leak, which I need to follow up on. So, but what I can give you is, fortunately, there is a similar chip. My understanding is this, and I don't quite understand the relationship, but the SkyWater PDK, I understand, possibly has some sort of relationship to this, some sort of partnership. I don't know details.
The SkyWater foundry was inherited from Cypress.
There we go. And my understanding is that this chip is made with the same PDK or very close to it or something like that. And Andrew took these shots a while back, and I thought I would add them in for completeness because we actually have a few high resolution shots from this. So anyways, same sort of high level overview that, you know, we saw in the previous shots. And then here's a close up he did where you can actually see an individual gate of some sort. You know, I don't know, this is like kind of like that NAND, you know, 2 that we saw earlier, something of that sort, you know, basic logic gate. So anyways, that's what I have, just kind of a basic quick tour through the package and the layers. If you want to take a look at these images, you can find some of them in that GSky folder. I haven't uploaded the two recent high resolution images from MPW1, but I will do that in the near future. And then there's the page that has Andrew's Cypress SEM images. It has a lot more shots of the chip, so if you want to do that for more information. So thanks for listening, and please contact me on Twitter, email, etc., if you want more information. Thank you.